Welcome to the Financial Freedom Podcast, where we interview remarkable people and share strategies for mastering money and living a meaningful life. With your host, Grant Sabatier, creator of Millennial Money and author of Financial Freedom, a proven path to all the money you will ever need.
Hey everyone, thanks for joining us on the Financial Freedom Podcast. This is a special bonus episode on behind the scenes of writing Financial Freedom. So I spent over 2,800 hours writing this book, learned an insane amount about how to pitch a book, how to sell a book, how to write a book, and how to launch a book. And I'm going to get into some of that backstory now. And I've welcomed Cody from Fly to Fi, who's going to be joining me on the 40 City Road to Financial Freedom book tour, which launches March 5th, coming to a city near you. Definitely don't miss us on that tour. So hey, Cody, let's chat about the book.
Yeah, definitely. And Grant, I mean, what an undertaking. You said 2,800 hours it took you?
2,800. It actually ended up taking me longer than that. It took me 2,800 hours to get the book into production with Penguin.
So you got to have some huge motivating factor behind you. I mean, where was the first idea that sparked the creation of Financial Freedom Book?
The first time that I thought about writing a book was actually pretty early on in blogging. So I launched Millennial Money in 2015 and really started getting a lot of traffic in 2016. And often the questions that I get from readers, they're pretty similar. They're, where should I start investing? How do I start a side hustle? How do I get a raise? How much money should I save? All those types of questions. And I've written almost 300 posts on the site. I certainly have long posts on these topics. But inevitably, when I'd send a link, I'd get another follow-up question and another question. And then I started getting the question, okay, I've read all these posts, but how did you exactly do it? And, you know, it quickly became clear that I wasn't going to be able to tell the entire story in a blog post. It also became clear that really only a small percentage of people read blogs. There's so many more people that don't than do, so many more people that don't listen to podcasts. And so I realized that I was going to have to write a book and wanted to write a book so I could tell the entire story. So I forever would have somewhere to point people when they ask me, how did you do it? How can I do it? Or even they ask me a specific money question, I no longer had to send out a link. And then I could, you know, reach people who don't listen to podcasts, don't read blogs. And then I could provide a resource if you have a friend or a family member or a spouse or a son or a daughter who, you know, you want to learn about money, you had something that you could give them. And a book is a really interesting thing because you're trying to put, you know, everything in a logical order between two covers. And once it's published, it's published. You know, I could always go delete the blog. Maybe the blog won't exist in 20 years, but this book will live on. It's a, and you know, writing a book is exceptionally different than writing a blog post. And then the final thing is I learned so much in my own financial independence journey. I never really had taken the time to fully reflect on it. And writing this book was actually a really emotional process. And also, you know, I've read over 400 personal finance, investing, and entrepreneurship books. I don't know how many I've read in total. I lost track at about 350. One of the things I'm going to do is keep a tally and create a list of all that I've read. But I'd never read a book like this. And so I wanted to write the book that I wish I had, you know, when I was starting my journey at 24, and pull all those pieces, all those best tips, all the things that I learned. I wanted to pull them together and reflect back on the journey to make it easier for others. So you don't have to do as much of the work digging that I did. And gosh, really excited to release the book.
Yeah, man. So I'm curious about process, because as a fellow writer, I mean, I've written 1,000 words and I'm like, this is crap, and just completely discarded it. And I'm sure you had a lot of that during the process of writing the book. So how did you do it? Did you time bunch? Were you writing in 30-minute hour blocks? Were you sitting down 24 hours without food or sleep? Like, what was the whole process there of writing the book?
So the process definitely evolved during the writing. the first thing whenever you're starting a book that you need and that my publisher required was a comprehensive outline. And so you need to kind of know where you're going. And I probably did, 20, 30 drafts of the outline. It took me a long time to decide what step should come before another step. I was pretty good at writing, 2,000 to 3,000 word blog post, but what I'd never done is string those together in a cohesive whole that builds. That's a logical strategy that anyone could follow. And this is really important because the first draft of the book that I wrote, Penguin completely rejected. My editor sent me back an email, I don't know if you can do this, which was really tough to hear. And honestly, I don't know if you know this, but quite a few books, a lot more than you think, even when you have a contract with a big publisher, they actually never get published. Either the author can't make it happen, the book's not good enough, the publisher, something happens with the publisher, it takes too long. And so even getting a book contract with a publisher doesn't guarantee that your book's going to get published, which is something that I didn't even know. So that's one thing there. But going back to your question, the hard thing for me was, getting that, I don't know if you can do this, after sending, 30,000 words and learning, having to learn how to write a book for the first time while writing a book. It's like trying to put the plane together while you're flying, man. Like that was its own unique challenge. And getting a good outline was essential. I really obsessed over making sure that all the pieces would fit together. And then, when I sent the second draft and got, the second round and got okay, great, now we're on the right path here, it was followed by, this is way too complicated for anyone to follow. Like you're starting at like in between intermediate and advanced, Grant. Like you need to back all the way up and, help, people figure out what all this stuff is before you drop them. And, you got to teach them how to fish before you drop them in the rainforest, And so then I had to go back and, take really the beginner's mind approach and, think, okay, if you knew nothing about money, where would you start? What are the essentials? How do you teach those? And so I'm saying this because from a process standpoint, I had to, learn how to write a book while writing a book. So I got the outline, and then the writing process is you need to really, there's a huge difference between drafting and free writing and actually editing. And this is one of the things is when you write a blog post, you're writing while editing at the same time. You're thinking, okay, you write a paragraph, you read it, you go back, you edit it, then you write half the blog post and you let it sit, and you come back and you edit it and keep writing. And that's not what you want to do when you're writing a book. And that's what I tried to do at first, and it just didn't work. And so what you have to do is you say, okay, I'm going to free write. I'm going to draft this chapter. Okay, I'm working on the side hustle chapter. I'm going to go in and this entire day or these 2 days, I'm just going to write. I'm just going to write where it goes. I'm just going to write. And then what happens is you leave that and you go to another chapter. You might free write on it for 2 or 3 days. And then you go back and you do it again in a different chapter. So you just leave the free writing. And then you move to another chapter and you write on something else. And then only then later do you come back and actually lay it all out. And, then you read it again. And then you have an editing day as opposed to a free writing day. Instead of that, that's how you do it. And so you give yourself permission to write some days and other days you're editing. For me, man, it wasn't very structured at all. I'm not the kind of person who gets up and I'm like, okay, it's 8 a.m. I'm going to write today. For me, it's like I would write for 3 or 4 days straight, 18 hours a day, crash for like 3 or 4 days, rejuvenate, and then do it again. And sometimes I had really, really productive weeks. Other times I didn't. I got stuck. I had to take breaks. It was an intense process, but I can feel when I'm on, and then I just got to ride that wave. Yeah, that was pretty much the process the entire way through. I got really intensely obsessed with being able to convey something very simply, and I also spent a fair amount of time reading aloud things that I'd written just to see how it flowed and the meter and the rhythm and making sure it was accessible. One of the biggest challenges I didn't anticipate was just, you know, over 40 charts in the book, you know, making sure those were perfect and said the right thing, were conveyed the right thing. That took a lot more time than I could have anticipated. And man, the challenge is like, you know, you sit down, you read the book in 4 or 5 hours. You know, I just read it last night, cover to cover. When you're reading it, it seems so simple. It's like you realize, I actually read books differently now because I realize how much is behind it. I can read books now after writing a book in half the amount of time, and I soak them up in it completely changed the way that I read books. Because I can see immediately how they're structured and how they were put together when before, you know, I didn't notice those things. It's amazing how much time goes, like 2,800 hours into something you can read in 4 or 5. It's tough to make it come across as simple and step by step. And also, you know, if I get the opportunity to write another one, which I hope I do, that, you know, I've learned how to write a book, so that, you know, that extra maybe 30% efficiency hopefully is built in. I also would have given myself more time. It would have been nice to have a full year of writing, and I didn't have that. I had to write all this in 8.5 months.
So at any point in the process, like when you got that 30,000 word revision and they said, this is junk, you have to go back and redo this, did you ever get just so lost and so bogged down that you were going to give up?
I never got to the point where I was going to give up. I got to the point certainly where I was scared that I wasn't good enough. Like being back at home with my parents with no money, it was that same hunger, that same intensity. I really recognize this as a once in a lifetime opportunity. You know, the way I sort of thought about it is, you know, it's like I got to try out for, you know, Capitol Records. You know, it's like I like got to audition at Def Jam. You know, it's like it felt like that to me. Biggest publisher in the world. My editor is the editor for the Dalai Lama, very well-known editor. I wanted to make the most of it. So I wasn't going to give up. No, I don't know how close I was. I was maybe like 2 or 3 months away from maybe not being able to make it happen. You know, so I had to move quickly. I had to learn quickly. I had to do all those things, but I wasn't going to go down lightly. And my editor, she really believed in me. You know, she still believed in me. She was very helpful in pointing me in the right direction and working with me and took the time to do that. So I feel grateful that she believed in me. So much of, I think, a book's quality depends on the editor and how much they believe in you and how much they're willing to work with you. And that's the thing, like publishers don't really buy books, editors do. And so you have to have someone who really believes in you. And you know, I feel very grateful for the team that I have at Penguin, because they believed in the message, they believed in the vision, they were willing to, you know, give me a little bit more time to figure it out. And man, yeah, you only get so many chances in life. And I really, 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 you know, didn't take this opportunity for granted.
So Grant, I think it would be really interesting for the listeners to hear just what the whole pitching process is like, because you got one of the biggest publishers, or the biggest publisher in the world, Penguin Random House. And I know that you disclosed to me that your editor has never worked on a finance or money related book before. So you obviously had something good going for you. So just what was that whole pitch process like when you were telling them this product that you were going to build?
So I knew I wanted to write a book before I put together a proposal or thought about, you know, how it actually make it happen. And so much of life is taking advantage of like a very small window. At least I feel that way. And I got one shortly after I was on NPR. About 100 book agents reached out to me and were like, your story's so interesting. You know, do you want to write a book? Do you want to, you know, all these agents, it was just a swarm of kind of TV and book people. And I was like, whoa, cool. Like, man, maybe this can actually happen. And so I scheduled calls with a bunch of them, about 20 of them. I did 11 calls with agents, and they all were some version of kind of salesy and sleazy, or, you know, just didn't feel like the right fit. They didn't have experience with these types of books. But clearly this signaled to me that there was interest in me writing a book, which I was really excited about. And I used this opportunity then to reach out to a few well-known agents who hadn't reached out to me, but I said, hey, all these agents reached out to me. Here's who I am. And I was able to have some calls with more well-known agents. One of them out in California, her authors have sold just tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of books. And she was extremely interested in the topic, the idea. I liked her vibe a lot. She had a proven track record. That's one of the things is you want to try to get the best agent that you can that have sold books, you know, similar to yours, or at least if you're writing a money book or a business book, you want to have someone who has experience selling those types of books and who has had successes, because, you know, successes don't happen overnight. An agent actually ends up being a huge part of the process. So, you know, I wanted someone who had that experience. So I found a great agent out in California, and time was then, you know, this all moved really fast. This is like a period of like 3 weeks. So I found the agent, signed the paperwork, and then had to write a book proposal. And a book proposal is, you know, you're selling the idea to a publisher, you're trying to. And with nonfiction books, you know, you have to, you know, say who you are, what the vision is for the book, how it's going to be structured, what it's about. You typically want to write an outline and a couple sample chapters. And then, you know, you build a marketing plan, which is, here's how I'm going to get this book out. Here's my platform. Here's who I am. And, you know, it's a pretty comprehensive document. Mine, I think, ended up being about 90 pages. I actually didn't write any sample chapters. I focused on the outline and the marketing and the pitching. And I wrote a really detailed analysis about this book and how there's not another book like it, and compared it. You actually, in the book proposal, put comparative titles, and you have to talk about what your book is like, but how it's different. And they want to know that you've read a bunch of books in this area. And so it helped that I'd read so many books about personal finance and investing. So I created the, you know, 90-page book proposal in a period of like 10 days. I mean, it was crazy. I was on a lot of planes at the time. I remember like writing it. I remember like writing it on this plane. I was flying from California to New York. It was like nonstop. And so 10 days to write the proposal. And then it got, you know, sent out to, you know, almost 20 publishers. And, you know, then calls were set up. And, you know, it was a process of, you know, you're trying to get your book to go to auction. And so people, you know, then bid it up. And, but it's, you're trying to do that and get a lot of interest while also trying to find the right fit for you, because fit is extremely important. You know, there's a lot of people out there that, you know, once you get to this stage, they might want to publish your book, but it might be a bad fit. And what I mean by that is a lot of publishers might want you to write a book about one area of the topic. So there's the publishers who were interested in me writing about just side hustling, for example, or just investing. And, you know, I wanted to write the book that I wanted to write. And so fit's really important. And I had calls with, you know, publishers, and, you know, it's all moving so fast. And my editor, you know, was very interested and wanted to buy the book and wanted to take it off the market. And so they do what's called a preemptive bid, which is they, you know, tell you what they want to pay for it. And it felt right. And I really liked them. And so they bought the book really after having, you know, like an hour and a half conversation, really detailed conversation. It moved so fast. And what she liked about the book and they liked about the book was the money is freedom focus, and the focus on how much is enough and not more, more, more. The fact that I obviously had lived it, the fact that, you know, I was thinking about kind of pushing against the normal personal finance advice, that I had such an issue with common personal finance wisdom, was attractive. And that, you know, I was really focused on this idea that money is not time and time is not money, and how I talked about that. And so that was, you know, it wasn't just another money book. It wasn't just another millennial book. It was something deeper and more soulful, I think, and more rich in that sense. And so, yeah, it moved fast, man. From the initial time I talked to my agent to the book being bought by Penguin, it was only a period maybe of like 6 weeks, I think. So it was really fast. And then it takes a long time to go through the contracting process, months and months and months. It's so many moving pieces entailed. And that's one of the other reasons you want a good agent, because they have experience with those. And the whole time then I'm working on the outline and preparing and chatting with my editor, and had a lot of really, you know, good long conversations about the book and the plan and, you know, all those things. So it can move pretty fast. But once again, one of the questions I get asked is, you know, why didn't you self-publish it? Because when you self-publish a book, you know, you get paid, obviously, you know, all you have to pay is the Amazon fee, or, you know, you get most of the money. That's not the case in traditional publishing. You don't get most of the money. The publisher gets most of the money. And there are a number of reasons I went with a traditional publisher. I couldn't have written this book without one. I didn't know how to write a book. I'm a big believer in try to work with the best people that you can. That's why I went with Penguin and wanted to go with Penguin, because, you know, they've been doing this a long time and they've got great resources, and I couldn't have written it without them. And also the credibility factor, the experience selling international rights. You know, the book's going to be published in Japanese and Chinese and Vietnamese and, you know, a bunch of languages. And I wouldn't have had that experience to sell those rights or manage that. And so I feel very grateful, you know, for Penguin making the dream come true. And the final product is so far beyond anything that even I could have imagined. They forced me to up my game and become a real writer and tell this story in the right way, and pushed me to leave it all on the floor. And I think that's the thing too, man, that no matter how well the book does, you know, I wanted to help as many people as possible and reach as many people as possible. But no matter what, one of the things I thought about is, after I wrote the book, I realized, you know, it's hard to write a book. It's really, really hard to try to write a great book or a good book. And for me, I just wanted to look back, you know, I thought about what would I be most proud of looking back when I'm, you know, 80 years old, if I make it there. And no matter what, I wanted to remember that I left it all on the floor, you know, and that's it, man. I really, with this thing, I collapsed at the finish line. I did. I wrote the best book that I could write with the time that I had. And that's it, man. That's all you can do in life. You know, you can really only truly do your best. And you set that bar for yourself, you know. Even though I had a publisher that had deadlines and stuff, there was no one peeking over my shoulder, forcing me to stay up late or edit that chapter another time. That investing chapter, you know, I wrote, I think, 13 or 14 different versions of it. You know, all of them are saved in a Dropbox folder. I figured out that I hit the keyboard over 3 million times while writing the book. 3 million times. And so that's a lot of writing, man, and a lot of thinking, because when I wasn't writing, I was thinking about it. I've never been one to like have a notebook or take notes, but when I started the book, I bought like a little Japanese notebook at a bookstore, like just a little journalist notebook I kept in my pocket the whole time. And that thing, I mean, every moment of the day when I wasn't writing phrases or sentences or ideas or how to put things together, you know, my mind was always on, even when it wasn't on. So yeah, I hope it helps a lot of people, and I feel proud of what it became and did the best I could. And, you know, someone asked me like, what if, you know, there are bad reviews or people criticize, you know, these things, and you can only do the best you can do. And I feel very grateful that the early reviews and interest and feedback has been really positive and really supportive. And I heard from one CFP who read an early copy. This is someone who gets paid to help people with their money. He said, this completely changed the way that I'm going to manage money in my own life. And then I heard from an 11-year-old who his dad won an advanced copy and gave it to him and wrote me an email, and he's like, this is so epic. It's literally changed the way that he's thought about money, and he's 11 years old, and what an advantage he now has. So I just can't wait to see what people do with it in their life, man. And it's already been all worth it. And then it makes it so easy now, if anyone ever asks me about money, I could just be like, read the book, you know? Oh, you obviously didn't read the book. You wouldn't be asking me that question. So I'm excited about that. I think it's certainly the reason I tracked all the hours is because I wanted to see what the net effect of that time will be over time, and not, you know, from a money-making standpoint, from an impact standpoint.
Yeah, that was a lot. It was a huge process, I can tell. Such an undertaking. Something I'm curious about is during the editing process, I mean, you do have a professional editor, you're working with the largest publisher in the world, but financial independence or financial freedom is a pretty niche topic. So were you bringing in subject matter experts to check out each chapter and edit for content and stuff like that? Because it's not a household topic that everyone knows about.
I feel grateful that I had kind of different, I wouldn't say levels of editors, but different editors for different things. And so my editor, who's the editor in chief of my imprint, you know, she's providing feedback on how it all flows and the takeaways and the concepts and the ideas. And it was awesome to talk about money with her because she had interesting ideas about money and, you know, she's thought about it and how it plays, you know, out in her own life. And so she knew a lot. It was cool. Some of the other editors that I worked with didn't have experience with money. And so they had more of a beginner's mind, which they were like, I don't know what this means. That meant that I wasn't clear enough, or, you know, this didn't make any sense, or this seems too crazy. So that was helpful. They didn't have that experience. I was actually amazed that the copy editors, you know, the people who are going line by line, they picked a copy editor who clearly had edited money books before and knew a lot about numbers, because they found some shifts in calculations I'd made, things that it was unbelievable what they were able to find. So the copy editor, who I actually never met, we would just correspond via email, knew a lot about and had experience with this topic. I also know that they were a baby boomer, because they would, like, it's so funny, like, occasionally, like, you're going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And I'd get into these, like, somewhat philosophical debates with my copy editor in, like, the margins of the copy, where she'd be like, you know, as a, you know, like, you could tell that she was a baby boomer, and she was talking about, oh, you know, I don't think about this way. And do you really believe that? You know, it was really actually super fun to do that. And then I had, you know, really incredible support from members within the FI community who, you know, were early readers. Drew from, you know, Guy on Fire was an early reader. He's a good friend of mine. He provided some really good feedback. All of the calculations and math and numbers, you know, I talked about with Chris from Keep Thrifty. He's a good friend of mine. He was like, I was in the trenches with him, even building, you know, building the calculators. He built most of the calculators. And JP Livingston, another blogger, you know, I spent a significant amount of time talking with her through how I structured elements of it. She was immensely helpful. And obviously she retired at 28. And so she's been through this. Of anyone, she and I spent the most time going back and forth. It was actually, she was literally going into labor, having her first child, and sent me comments that morning as she was, like, going into labor, which I think is so awesome and so hardcore. Shout out, JP. Much love to you. And yeah, I have spent so much time even outside of that, obviously talking with other bloggers. And Brandon from The Mad Scientist, who's in the book, whose story's in the book, you know, was the first FI blogger that I found. I was like 2.5 years into doing it by myself when I found him. And I was like, it was like, I remember, like, it was like, I read every single thing that he'd written. And I was like, first, I'm not alone in this. Second, this dude is like so far ahead of me. I can, you know what I mean? I have so much to learn. I didn't know like anything about tax optimization. And so that was incredible. And then I found Pete, and, you know, then I found others. But even, man, 2012, 2013, there weren't many people writing about this stuff. So I was still alone in some cases. But, you know, I've learned so much from so many people. These ideas, I'm building on the shoulders of others. I lived it and I did it, and I was alone for 2.5 years, but then I learned from so many people. You know, this is really a community effort, hands down, man. And that's the cool thing about it, because, and that's what I'm really excited about, is because there's so many people involved in it. There's, you know, it took so many people to bring to life, from learning from everyone, all the sharing, all the other great authors whose books I read and learned from. And that's the cool thing, man. You're always trying to just push things forward. At the time I started writing the book, man, this is 2017, the FIRE movement really was very small. It's getting bigger and it's growing, but it was really small. So I was like, I got to get this stuff out there. And even still, we've still reached such a small number of people, and I'm so excited to see it all growing. And one of the things I wanted to do was take all the ideas that changed my life and put them all together so other people could follow them, no matter where they're at in their own financial journey. And so I didn't just want to write a FIRE book, you know, or just here's how to get to FI. I wanted to, if that's not even your goal, I wanted to help you. And that's why, you know, I dedicated the book to anyone who's stressed out about money. You don't have to want millions of dollars or be financially independent, I think, to learn a lot from the book.
Yeah, man. That was something I really liked about the book, is that you shared your personal journey, but it wasn't just the grant story. And it also wasn't just a template. It wasn't just all these boring math equations. Like, you intertwine them, so it's a real person going through this journey, showing other people how they can do it too. And like you said, it's a community effort. It's like you're creating the Bible for the FIRE religion is what you're doing with this book, and just giving people the template.
Yeah. I mean, at the time I started, I don't know if Brandon wants to write a book or will ever write a book, or Pete will write a book or ever write a book. I know a lot of people want him to. And when I started writing this, there was Your Money or Your Life and A Simple, you know, Path to Wealth. And, you know, those are very different than the book I wrote. I wanted to make sure it all got out there, because, man, it's really hard to be like, oh, wow, you're interested in FI. Now here's, you know, 18 blog posts that I really like. And here's this and here's that and here's this. And so I was like, I also, especially younger people, you know, that's one of the things I'm really passionate about. And I'm really excited that middle schools have sort of started catching on to this. And I've been chatting with middle schools and curriculum developers. And I mean, I'm pumped, man, for that 12-year-old to read this book. And, you know, they're not someone who's probably going to stumble on a FIRE blog, or maybe not, or who knows. And so just to be able to read something like this and be like, I can live a life I love. Like, this is accessible to me. I can live my life differently than people tell me I should be living my life. I can have more freedom and choices and time. And to me, this is like, it's a life philosophy. You know, it's about so much more than money. Just like when I read Your Money or Your Life, that was a life philosophy to me. And I can't not mention the fact that I'm standing on the shoulders of giants. Your Money or Your Life changed my life. And Vicky, Robin, and I are now very close. And she wrote the foreword to the book. And I very much view myself as a branch on the tree, on her tree. And so I can't wait for it to be out in the world. I can't wait to hear what you think.
All right. So Grant, after undergoing this huge process of writing this book and just getting all your ideas and thoughts out, dozens of revisions. I mean, you got so much pushback in some chapters, you had to rewrite them 13 or 14 different times. To the person who's out there thinking that they might want to write a book, sharing their experiences, sharing their life journey, or just the knowledge that other people might want to have, what is your biggest piece of advice to that person?
I think the best piece of advice I can give is take the time to really plan out what you want to say, and what makes you different, and what makes your story different. And also think long and hard about why you're doing this. Because I think a lot of people write books for the wrong reasons. And, you know, it's fine if you want to write a book to build a business or get clients, but the world doesn't need another fluffy book. And so your first, you know, your heart really has to be in it. It's going to take you a lot of time. It's going to be tough. If you want it to be good, it's going to be a really long and hard process. And so make sure that you're getting into it for the right reasons. Really write a book if you feel like you really have something that has to be said. I'm not saying you can't write a book just to get something off your chest or just have fun with it. Just realize, just like money, the trade-off that you're going to make. It's going to take a lot of time. It's going to be hard. And so figure out what you really want to say. Figure out how you want to say it. I was talking to someone, they asked me this question the other day, and I said, you know, before you do anything, just like, it's like being a, just get in a room with a bunch of paint and start painting and see where it takes you and see how it feels. You know, before you write a book, write. You know, that's what the best thing about blogging is, like, you get, you know, it's like training in a gym. You know, you learn how to write, you see what people react to, you see how they respond, you see how it makes you feel. And so blogging is the perfect training ground for writing. Very hard to go from not having written at all to writing a book. So make sure you take the time to flex your muscles and build your muscles a little bit. And then, yeah, really figure out what you want to say. What mark do you want to leave on the world? What hasn't been said that needs to be said? What's calling you, like, at your core? And if you don't know, I mean, if you want to write a book and something's really not calling you, it's not the time to write a book. You're not going to figure out what you want to write about in the middle of writing a book. I mean, you can do that if you want. I just don't think it's probably the best use of your time. You know, a book calls you, a book will obsess you. It'll, you know, you won't have to think about working hard because you'll have no other choice. You know, that's the thing about me. I didn't think like, oh, I got to put in 10 hours today. The book just pulled me. I mean, it came out of me. Something has to speak to you. So if you're there and you're ready to write, then you got to put together an outline. That's the next step. Get everything organized and, you know, take as much time as you need, but you got to really want to write a book and you got to have something to say.
Well, thanks for pulling us behind the scenes, Grant. This has been a lot of fun, just kind of figuring out the process and all the work that goes into a book. Like you said, people are tearing through this thing in 4 or 5 hours, or maybe if they're new to the content, it might take them a little bit longer, but you poured 2,800 hours of your life to create this book. So, I mean, kudos to you.
Yeah, man, time I'm never going to get back. So I hope it's worth it. And it definitely was for me. But hey, man, thanks for the interview, Cody. I hope you all enjoy it. Check out financialfreedombook.com, available worldwide. And I can't wait to hear your thoughts. Hit me up on Twitter at Millennial Money, at Financial Freedom on Instagram, hashtag Financial Freedom. I'd love to hear what you think and love to hear your stories, how you're using it in your own life. And hope you have a good day, and I'll see you soon.
Thanks for listening to the Financial Freedom Podcast. If you enjoyed this episode, please leave us a review and subscribe. To learn more, get show notes, and dive deeper, visit financialfreedombook.com.